The townspeople have heard incredible reports on the radio that corpses are rising from their graves and eating people alive. Several brave individuals from the town are not willing to surrender their homes to the undead, and they decide to fight and defend what is rightfully theirs. Leading the fight is a local Catholic priest named Father Joseph McGinnis. He is convinced that this evil must be confronted, and he has persuaded three other locals to help him. The first is the local high school quarterback named Johnny Miller. Johnny was heard saying, "Let's go, Father. I ain't going out like a chump." Johnny's girlfriend has also decided to make a stand. Amanda Collins has been elected as prom queen 2 years in a row, and she's not about to let a few zombies spoil her chance at a third. Finally, there is a bush pilot from Timber Peak named Nikki Peters. She is convinced that someone must take a stand, and she's just the gal for the job.
Hello everyone and welcome to my channel. Thank you for joining me at the Solo Gamers Club. Tonight, we'll be playing Last Night on Earth, the zombie game. But before we get started, I want to provide the viewers with an update regarding my efforts at developing a campaign system for the game. The system that I'm about to outline is still in the developmental stage, so some of the following concepts and mechanics are subject to change. Earlier last year, I developed some solo rules for the game. This task was fairly easy to complete. However, the creation of a campaign system for the game was not. The scenario-based, episodic nature of the game made it very difficult to develop a system that felt right, and I spent many hours contemplating various ideas. I began the creation process by designing a campaign map that included the locations that were referenced in the rule books and in the hero biographies. Colored rectangles are used to differentiate the different locations, and special rules were assigned to each of the major locations to give them a unique and thematic feel. The special rules were based on the size of the municipality, whether it was a town or a city, and its geographic location relative to mountains, forests, etc. These special rules will be active during every scenario played at that location. The square locations, representing the Ancor Chemical Plant and the camping area for the Timber Peak State Forest, are only used as a part of some of the starting scenarios. The map provides some additional information for use during the campaign. These elements include a letter in the upper left-hand corner of the location boxes, which will identify the scenarios available at the site, and travel numbers, which are used as a part of the travel procedure when moving between locations. Travel across the campaign map is resolved by selecting a travel route and consulting the route's travel number. It's a number inscribed in the circle. A D6 is rolled, and if the result is greater than the travel number, the move is successful. If heroes successfully travel to a new location, they will gain the special ability Hero Cards 1 during their next scenario. This represents the advantage of the heroes not spending too much time in a single area and unduly attracting the zombie horde's attention. If the result is equal to the travel number, the move was successful, but a casualty occurred. Randomly remove one hero from the hero pool. If the result is less than the travel number, the attempt was unsuccessful, and the heroes must remain in their current location. In addition, a random hero is killed during the attempt and removed from the campaign. Record the loss on the hero campaign sheet. A campaign begins by consulting the starting scenario table and rolling a D8. The result will provide the player with the opening scenario, some background text, and a starting location for the campaign. Place the campaign marker on the indicated location of the campaign map. Then the scenario is played using my Last Night on Earth solitaire rules. These rules help to codify the solitaire play of the game and they address the deck bloat that occurs if using the elements of multiple expansions. If the player wins a scenario, they may attempt to travel to an adjoining location, or they may remain in the current location and remove any unplayed scenario from the location's list, and that's identified with that letter designation in the upper left corner of the site. Then a random scenario is chosen from those remaining on the location's list. Note that the location's finale scenario, the scenario marked with an asterisk, can only be played when it is the last scenario on the location's list. If the player lost the scenario, they may attempt to travel to an adjoining location, or they must remain in the current location and play the lowest numbered scenario remaining on the location's list, even if this repeats the last scenario played. The zombies gain one extra zombie card to start the next scenario following a loss. This represents the zombies gaining small tactical advantage throughout the region. Once the starting scenario is completed, the player will select four heroes to play the next scenario. The available heroes are charted on the hero campaign chart. Heroes that survive a scenario, regardless if the scenario was won or lost, may reappear in future scenarios, and they will gain some added benefits, representing the proficiency they've gained in battling the undead. The player should try to choose the heroes whose skills would be most effective during the next scenario. Surviving heroes will retain any XP and upgrades that they've earned. In addition, the hero may keep one item that was in their possession at the conclusion of the previous scenario. Record the information on the hero campaign chart. If the player loses a scenario, the player must determine the fate of each hero by rolling a d6. On a result of 1 to 4, the hero has died during the aftermath and is removed from play. If the hero was infected, apply a -1 dice roll modifier to the roll. The heroes win the campaign by successfully completing the finale scenario in their location, or by successfully completing the escape in the plane scenario at the Fort Baxter Air Base location. The heroes lose the campaign the instant the hero pool becomes depleted. If the heroes fail the finale scenario in a location, they must immediately flee to an adjacent location. If there is no eligible adjacent location to move to, the heroes lose the campaign. When the heroes flee, they automatically succeed in the attempt, but D3 heroes are randomly removed from the hero pool. The object of the campaign is for the player to complete the scenarios at a location without losing too many heroes. The primary locations, Woodenvale, Brightston, and Timber Peak, contain 6 scenarios each, including a finale scenario. The Timber Peak State Park and the Fort Baxter Air Base locations have only 1 scenario. These are special locations that form a unique method for the heroes to win the campaign. Failed scenarios may be replayed multiple times. However, once a scenario is successfully completed, it is removed from the campaign. So that completes a brief overview of the campaign system that I've developed. If the viewers are interested in this, I can post this on the BGG site for anyone that might be interested in playing this. What I'm going to do now is we're going to play a scenario using the solitaire rules that I developed. And this scenario is going to be a part of this campaign series that I'm going to be producing. This is going to probably take quite a while, and these episodes will be intermittent throughout the coming months. But what I'll try to do is make steady progress on proceeding through the campaign, and we'll see how it works out. As you saw in the prologue, we're going to be playing Die Zombies Die scenario, and that was rolled using our starting scenario table that I developed. And the action is going to take place in the town of Woodenvale. We have the choice between Woodenvale or Brightston, and I selected Woodenvale. At Woodenvale, the special rules that are in effect will be survival decks, grave weapons, exploration markers, and feral dead too. As a part of the hero campaign sheet, I created a table, and it's a D1000 table that will allow me to randomly roll up a hero when we need one. Now, prior to the start of the game, I rolled up 6 heroes, and I selected 4 to start the game. And you saw those in the prologue. That's Father Joseph, Nikki the bush pilot, Amanda the prom queen, and Johnny the high school quarterback. I created a few extra tables to help me select the L-shaped boards that are going to be used to create the game board. And the reason I did this is I noticed that in the original game and in the Timber Peak expansion, there's 2 boards that have the same locations on them, namely like the high school and the hospital. And I didn't want to have 2 locations on the map that are the, you know, that are the same locations. So what I did is I created several tables, one to be used in Woodenvale and Brightston, and another one to be used in Timber Peak. So we're going to use a D8 to make a roll. The first 6 are on that location, and then the 2 from the Growing Hunger boards would always be available. So in other words, you use a D8 to roll, no matter which table you're using, and if it's a 7 or 8, it would be those tiles from the Growing Hunger boards. So I'm going to create the board, and we'll place our models on it and get started. And during this playthrough, I'm going to preview my new dice tower. My rolling is so terrible that I decided to get a dice tower in the hope that it would maybe improve my dice rolls throughout all the games that I play. So what I did is I purchased this one. It's very clicky though. So in other words, it's going to make a lot of noise. So what I did is I installed some small pieces of rubber on the baffles and at the bottom, and it's fairly quiet. So it works pretty good, and I'm pretty happy with it, and maybe it'll make a difference with my dice rolls. All right, the game board is now set, and we've placed the heroes on their starting spots. In the northwest corner of the board, we have the barn, which has a pickup item pitchfork. We have a farmhouse, and we have the cornfield. The cornfield is interesting. It says that zombies must roll a 4+ to find and attack a hero here. So that's a good hiding spot for us. In the northeast corner, we have the airplane hangar that has a pickup item of the signal flare, which interestingly enough, Nikki, the bush pilot, starts with a signal flare. So that's a way for her to use the pickup item option. We have a hospital, and that pickup item is any first aid card. There's also a morgue there, and then we have the diner. The pickup item there is the meat cleaver. In the southeast corner of the board, we have the church. Pickup item there is faith, a graveyard, and the police station. The pickup item there is the pump shotgun. Finally, at the southwest corner of the board, we have the bank. There is no pickup item there. We have a junkyard. And it says the pickup item is a random card from the hero discard pile. Must be at least 5 cards to pull from. And then we have a gas station, and the pickup item there is gasoline, which could be useful. All of the building locations that do not contain a hero to start the game have an exploration token placed on them. Now, the Die Zombies Die scenario is interesting in that it does not have any scenario items attached to it. So what we've done is we've created our zombie and hero decks. We shuffled all the cards together. And we counted out 65 for each deck. Now, part of the Woodenvale special rules has a feral dead attached to it. So we've placed 2 feral dead on their feral dead card, and the zombies can spawn those at a cost of 2 spawn points and 1 experience point. Now, they have a special ability called Relentless. Anytime the feral dead wins a fight, the hero must immediately fight that feral dead again. We've assembled our zombie pool, which consists of 14 zombies. And the scenario also offers survival tactics and unique items to the heroes. And those, how those work is when a hero is in a building, if they roll a 5 or 6 for movement, instead of taking a pickup item or drawing a hero card, they can choose to get a survival tactic or unique item depending upon the building number that they're in. The hero and zombie upgrades are also a part of the scenario, as is grave weapons. And for grave weapons, the zombies can spend 2 spawn points and make one of the zombies a grave dead. Now, the only hero that starts in a building is Father Joseph. He begins in the church. The other 3 heroes, their starting spaces are not on the board, and they're going to start in the center of the board, and each of them are going to gain an extra hero card. Nikki is going to start with a flashlight and pitchfork. Amanda is going to gain an event card called Hero's Rage. And Johnny is going to start with dynamite. Okay, so those are the starting items. The event cards are placed into a community pool, and any of the heroes can use those whenever they wish. But if it's an item, those get attached to the heroes that find them. Now, Nikki begins the game with that signal flare. Now, this flashlight and pitchforks card is a double-handed weapon. So she's only allowed, that would count as 2 of the 2 weapons that she's allowed to have in her possession. So she's going to give that flashlight and pitchfork to Amanda. The game is now set, and we're ready to start with the zombie hero turn. And we begin with the move the sun track step of the zombie turn. And in the first turn, we simply place the sun track marker on the number of turns indicated on the scenario card. So we'll start with 15. And we've placed it as such. The next step is to draw new zombie cards. And with the solitaire rules, the zombie hand limit has been reduced from 4 down to 3. I have thought about this. My original rules were just that. We reduced the number of zombie cards in their hand limit to 3. And that's because we have a zombie fight deck, and we've taken basically 20% of the cards out of the mix, and those are used to, whenever a zombie is in a fight with a hero, they roll a d10, and on a result of 9 or 10, a fight card is available to them. So we've reduced the hand limit from 4 down to 3, and I've decided to keep it that way. After my last playthrough, I thought maybe it might be better served to have that hand limit back at 4, but I think we'll leave it at 3. So we're going to draw 3 cards from the zombie deck. And those cards are revealed to be Zombie Surge, that's a sacrifice card, Bitten, and Strength of Hate. Now, Strength of Hate is a play immediately card. How the zombie hand is going to work with the solitaire rules is we immediately play all play immediately cards, we resolve those, and then the remaining cards we play whenever they're able to be played based upon the card text. It'll be either during a hero turn or during a zombie movement phase or etc. So we're going to resolve that Strength of Hate card right now. Now that Strength of Hate card is a remains in play card, and it says that they can discard it to let the zombies roll an extra fight dice. This does not count as a fight card. So we'll put that off to the side in the zombie card area, and then they can employ that whenever it would be tactically prudent. Now the Bitten card says play this card on a hero when they kill a zombie in a fight. The next time the hero would be wounded, instead they are turned into a zombie hero. So that card would be in their hand and it would be played if that event occurs. The other one is Zombie Surge, and it says immediately spawn D6 zombies. These zombies may move and fight normally this turn. Now it has a sacrifice condition associated with it. It says choose any hero on the board to immediately draw a hero card. So I think what we'll do is we'll have Father Joseph draw the card, and then we're going to spawn D6 zombies. Father Joseph draws Hopeful Discovery, and that's a play immediately card. Look at the top 5 cards of the hero deck. Choose 1 to take, 1 to discard, and put the rest back on top of the deck in any order. Or take any scenario search item from the discard pile or hero deck, shuffle the hero deck. Well, he'll do that. He's going to look at the top five cards. He'll choose one, discard one, and put the rest back in the order he chooses. And the five cards are revealed to be a stockpile first aid card, escape through the windows, faith, emergency flare, and hopeful discovery. And I think Father Joseph would probably discard the escape through the windows card. That'll be the discarded card on that. He would probably keep the faith card, and he has a pickup at the church for faith, so I think that would make sense. So we'll put that faith card in the community pool for events, and the other three we will put back on top of the hero deck in any order we choose. So I think probably the best would be the emergency flare, followed by hopeful discovery, and then stockpile first aid. Now before we complete that zombie surge card, I neglected to put out our starting zombie. So we have to roll 2d6, and that'll be the number of zombies that'll appear in the spawning pits. So let's take care of that right now. And here's the roll for the number of starting zombies. And we rolled a total of 9. Okay, so 9 zombies are going to come out. All right, so we've placed the starting 9 zombies. There's 2 in each of the corners, southwest corner, northwest corner, and northeast corner. And 3 will start in the graveyard at the southeast corner. That's closest to Father Joseph, so we've done it that way. Now we're going to roll a d6, and we'll be able to place that many extra zombies as a part of that zombie surge card. And here's the roll, and that's a 6. Okay, so they've rolled 6, and that'll place all the remaining zombies that are in the pool. There's 5 there. So all of the zombies in the pool, with the exception of the feral dead, have been deployed to the board. We've got 3 in each corner, with 4 being in the graveyard at the southeast corner of the board. So the heroes will have their work cut out for them. But as a part of this scenario, the scenario rules, to win, the heroes must kill 15 zombies by sundown. And the zombies will win if the heroes fail or by killing 2 heroes. The next step would be roll to spawn new zombies. Well, we have all 14 are on the board, so there's no way we can roll greater than 14 with 2 dice. So there won't be any new zombies this turn. Now we get to move the zombies. All right, all of the zombies have moved 1 space. We've got a large cluster of 5 here that have broken through the walls in the church. And Father Joseph is there, and he's astonished to see 4 zombies busting through the walls. In the southwest corner of the building, the zombies moved from the junkyard, and they're moving towards the center of the board, as are the other zombies from those directions. The next step would be fight heroes. There's no heroes in a fight situation. And then it would go on to place newly spawned zombies. There won't be any. And that's going to complete the zombie turn. We'll move on to the hero turn. All right, let's take a look at the strategy we're going to use for the heroes. Now, Amanda has an interesting special rule called Beautiful. Any male hero in the same space may roll an extra fight dice. So I think it makes sense for us to pair Johnny and Amanda up wherever they move to keep them together. That'll give Johnny an extra fight dice. Plus, he can kind of help to protect her a little bit. Second is the position of the board. Well, we have 3 exploration tokens in the southwest corner of the board. So that probably would be a good spot for the heroes to go to, and they could easily pick up some hero cards by entering those buildings. Now the cornfield is also another interesting place for defense. The zombies have to roll a 4+ in order to find and attack a hero in that space. So that's also interesting. Now Johnny has that dynamite. It has a range of 2. He can throw it into a space, and it's going to kill all the zombies in that space on a roll of 2+. And it says any hero is killed on a roll of 5+. So there won't be any heroes there. So I think what we're going to do is we're going to have Johnny throw that dynamite near the gas station here, and he's going to try to take those zombies out. Then the other heroes could maybe move into those buildings and use those exploration tokens. So I think that's what we're going to do. Now, the only problem with that plan is that if you examine the dynamite card more closely, it says that you must have a fire item to use dynamite. So he's going to have to try to acquire a fire item first. So I think what we're going to do then is I'm going to start with Johnny, and we'll have him roll for movement and see if he can get into one of the buildings that's safer and attempt to use the exploration token to try to get a card. Okay, so here's the roll for movement. And Johnny rolled a 2, so he's got 2 movement points to use. Well, that's not enough movement to enter a building to get an exploration token, so I think we'll move Johnny south 2 points, 1 and 2. And that will still keep them 3 spaces away from him minimum. And I think that's about all we'll be able to do with Johnny for the turn, and we will mark him as previously activated. And I think next we'll activate Amanda, so we'll have her roll for movement. She has that flashlight and pitchfork, which helps to kind of keep the zombies away from her. When they enter a space, they have to roll a die, and only on a 4 or greater can they enter the space. That pitchfork keeps them away. So here's her roll for movement. And she rolls a 6. Okay, so she's got 6 movement points. And I think she's going to take a chance, and I'm going to have her enter the bank. And she can draw that exploration token. So she's going to move 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. And she enters the bank, and then we're able to turn over that exploration token. And we get a free search. That's great. So she's going to draw a card. And that card is the emergency flare that we saw with that previous card, where we were able to look at the top 5 cards. It says a hero may ignore the effects of lights out, discard at any time to instantly wound a zombie in your space on a D6 of 2 or greater. So she's going to keep that emergency flare card, and she can give that to Johnny, and that would help him with his dynamite issue. So we'll have her take the emergency flare. And now, as that flashlight and pitchfork is a double-handed item, that counts as 2 of her carrying capacity, which is a total of 4. So right now she would be at a total of 3 carrying capacity. And she has no ability to exchange items or a ranged attack, and there are no fights, so we'll mark her as previously activated. And next up, I think we're going to activate Father Joseph. He's in the church right now. And he's pretty much being overwhelmed over there. There's 5 zombies within 1 space of him. So we'll have him roll for movement. And here's his roll. And he rolls a 1, unfortunately. That's not very good. Well, he can either stay in the church and draw a search card, or he can move out the door, and then that would limit the number of zombies that could swarm him, I guess. I think that's probably the best bet at this point. So we'll have him move 1 space, and then that at least only has 3 instead of 5 zombies within range. So I think that's what he'll do. And that's pretty much going to end his turn. We'll mark him as previously activated, and that leaves us with Nikki, the bush pilot, left. So Nikki will roll for movement, and she rolls a 1 too. Oh boy, not good. And I think she's going to use that to move west towards the cornfield, and then she's going to employ now her signal flare. The signal flare has a range of 4. It says you can target 1 zombie within range, roll a d6, and the zombie is killed on a 2 or greater, discard when fired. Okay, so she's going to try to help out, I think, Father Joseph, and she'll target 1, 2, 3 spaces away. She'll go after that zombie right here, and we'll see if she is successful. Okay, and here is her attack roll with the signal flare. She rolls a 5, and that is a success. That zombie is killed. That is great. And Nikki is going to earn an XP for killing the zombie. That is great. All right, that zombie is going to be placed into the zombie pool. And Nikki has earned her first experience point, which is great. And we're going to mark Nikki as previously activated, and that is going to end the hero turn. We'll move on with another zombie turn. And it's important that we keep track of the zombies that we kill, and so we're going to put our marker on 1 now. And that's important because we have to get 15 for the heroes to win the scenario. And we begin the new zombie turn by moving the sun track. It's going to move from 15 down to 14. So the heroes have 14 turns to kill 14 more zombies. And the next phase is to draw new zombie cards. The two cards that we could not play from last turn are discarded, and we draw 3 fresh cards. And those are revealed to be I Feel Kinda Strange, Angry Dead, and Lights Out. Let's take a closer look at those cards. Okay, the first card is I Feel Kinda Strange. It says play this card on a hero when they take a wound from a zombie. The next time the hero would be wounded, instead they are turned into a zombie hero. Remains in play. Okay, and then we have Angry Dead, and that's a sacrifice card. It says while this card is in play, anytime a hero loses a fight, reveal and discard the top 3 hero cards. If this discards the last hero card, the heroes automatically lose. Remains in play. And then we have Lights Out. Play this card at the start of the zombie turn on any building to place a Lights Out marker on it. The zombies have cut the power. Any hero moving into the space within this building immediately ends their move. Remains in play. Well, the start of a zombie or hero turn is considered to be any time from the start of the turn until a model is moved. So this is technically still the start of the zombie turn. So they're going to play that Lights Out card, and then we're going to find out which building they're going to place that Lights Out marker on. Now, I should note that when I said that the cards that the zombies did not play were discarded from the previous turn, that's true. The Bitten card was discarded, but that Strength of Hate card was a Remains in Play card. So we're going to keep that on a small tray next to the zombies play area, and then when that card is able to be played, it can be played. It does not count against their hand limit. Now the same thing would be true with this Angry Dead card. If the zombie players discard a total of 2 cards from their hand, that card is activated and that remains in play. And it says while it's in play, anytime a hero loses a fight, reveal and discard the top 3 cards from the hero deck. If this discards the last hero card, the heroes automatically lose. So in order for the zombies to play that card, they would have to discard 2 cards from their hand. So they won't be able to do that this turn, other than if they don't play that Lights Out card. So that would be a decision to make for the zombies. Yeah, I think that that's what they're going to do. They're going to discard these 2 cards and then play that Angry Dead card, which remains in play, and then that would start to work on the hero deck a little bit. So I think that's what we're going to do. Zombies will discard those 2 cards, and this Angry Dead card will be remains in play. We'll put that on the card track that I've got near their play area. I think that's a smart play. Okay, the next step is to roll to spawn new zombies, and unfortunately, the zombies have 13 zombies on the board, and it would be impossible for them to roll greater than that with 2 dice, so there will be no more zombies to be spawned this turn. And now we'll move on to the move zombies phase. And I guess we're going to start in this southwest quadrant, and we'll start moving the zombies. Definitely one of them will burst through the wall and move towards Amanda. One will move towards Johnny, and then I think the other one would move up into that space towards Nikki. And we'll do a similar thing with the zombies in the northwest quadrant. Probably place as many of those as we can within one space of her. That would seem to make sense. And then we've got the zombies in the northeast corner, and I think we'll move all those into here. And then these zombies that are near Father Joseph, will definitely, by zombie hunger, are going to move in and attack him, and the other ones will move as well. All right, that completes the zombie movement. We'll move on to fight heroes. All right, now it's time to fight heroes, and we do have one battle, and that's going to be Father Joseph in front of the church against two zombies. First thing we have to do is roll a d10 and find out if the first zombie is going to be eligible for a fight card. And here's the roll. The zombies rolled an 8, so there's no zombie fight card played for this fight. But they are going to play one of their remains in play cards, and that's going to be this Strength of Hate card. And that says, discard this card to let a zombie roll one extra fight dice. This does not count as a fight card. All right, and then so this is going to be discarded, but the zombies will gain one extra fight dice for that first turn. So they got two of them right now. All right, now Father Joseph is going to play some cards, and these are going to be quite powerful for him. The first one is going to be Faith. Play on any hero until the end of the turn, that hero rolls an extra fight dice. If played on a holy hero, faith remains in play. So Father Joseph has the keyword holy. So this is going to remain in play until it is discarded by a zombie card. So that's going to give Father Joseph an extra card. So we'll keep that out, and I'll put that near his card as he's primarily going to be the person using that. All right, and he's also going to play one more card, and that is going to be Hero's Rage. Play on any hero that has two or more zombies in their space. Until the start of the next hero turn, that hero rolls an extra fight dice and kills any zombie beaten in a fight, even if no doubles were rolled. Limit one heroic card per hero. All right, so that's not a problem. He's going to play that card, so that's going to give him quite a few extra fight dice for this fight. So Father Joseph is going to be rolling his normal two dice, plus one extra for the Hero's Rage, and an additional extra one for his Faith card that is active. All right, we're going to make the roll for the first zombie attack on Father Joseph. Okay, and here we go. All right, these are the results. All right, so we pair up the highest value of each set of dice. That means Father Joseph is going to win 6-2. On that first one, and that card says in the Hero's Rage, it says it kills any zombie beaten in a fight, even if no doubles were rolled. So Father Joseph is going to kill that first zombie. He's dead. And that's going to earn him a XP. So we'll mark Father Joseph with an XP. Now the next zombie is going to attack him. The first step there is to see if the zombies get a zombie fight card. Roll is a 4, so there'll be no card for that, no fight card. And now we'll roll for the attack. In this case, the zombie only gets his normal 1 fight die, and Father Joseph will still be rolling 4. And here's the roll. All right. 6, a 4, a 3, and a 2 for Father Joseph. And the zombies rolled a 3. So we compare the 6 and the 3. Father Joseph has won that battle, and that's going to kill the zombie beaten in a fight, even if no doubles were rolled. So another zombie is dead, earning Father Joseph another XP. And we're going to move up the tally on the scenario card by 2. So that's going to put us up to 3 zombies killed out of the 15 we need. That was actually quite good for Father Joseph. So we're going to place those dead zombies into the zombie pool. There's 3 of them in there now, and that's not including the 2 feral zombies that are available. Then we'll add these XP to Father Joseph's card, and if he can get one more, he'll be able to get an upgrade. And that's going to end that step. The next step would have been to place newly spawned zombies. There won't be any. We didn't roll any during that step three. So we'll move on to the hero turns. And I think how we're going to approach this is I'm going to start the turn by activating Amanda. She's currently in the bank. She needs to get away from that zombie that's near her anyway. And I'm going to try to get her to move into the space with Johnny. And once she's there, she'll be able to exchange items with him, giving him the emergency flare. And then that would allow him, in his turn, to use his dynamite. So I think that's what we're going to try to do. We're going to make a roll for movement for Amanda. And here's her roll. And she rolls a 4, so she's going to have 4 movement points to use during this turn. And that's going to be more than enough to get her into Johnny's space. So we're going to move her 1, 2, and 3. And that's going to meet, she'll meet up with Johnny outside the bank. And then the next step is the exchange items step. And that's where we're going to give, Amanda's going to give that emergency flare card. She'll give that to Johnny, which is a fire item. And that will allow him to use his dynamite during his turn. And the next steps for Amanda would be the ranged attack and fight zombies. None of those will happen. So that's going to end Amanda's turn, and we are going to mark her as previously activated. All right, I think next up is going to be Johnny himself. Now, his dynamite that he has a range of 2. So I want to be able to probably target this one of the two groups of 3 zombies there to the north of the board. So we're going to have to try to move him into range of one of those groups. So we're going to make a roll for movement for Johnny. All right, here's his roll. And he rolls a 1, unfortunately. Oh boy, not good. Well, I think considering the situation, if he moves one space, he would still be in range of to be able to throw that dynamite. That'll leave Amanda by herself, though. But I think that's what we're going to do. So Johnny's going to move one space, and then that would place these zombies in range of his dynamite. So 2 spaces. And then I think that's what he's going to do during his ranged attack step. He's going to use that dynamite. So Johnny is going to use his dynamite that he has. He's going to use the emergency flare, which is a fire item, and he's going to use that to light the dynamite, and I think he's going to throw those at the zombies that are closest to Nikki. So he's going to throw that 2 spaces, and we're going to roll a die for each of the zombies in that space, and we're going to kill them on a roll of 2 or greater. So Johnny will roll 3 dice, and we'll kill 1 zombie for each 2 or greater that we roll. Here's the roll. And we rolled a 2, a 2, and a 3. So all 3 of those zombies are going to be killed in one massive explosion. We've knocked out 3 of them. That's absolutely fantastic. That is going to raise our zombie count up from 3 to 6. So we've only need 9 more to take out. The dynamite is discarded, but the emergency flare is not. That is only used as a fire item to light the dynamite. So the 3 zombies that were killed with the dynamite explosion, we'll put those into the zombie pool. There's a total of 6 of those in there now. And that's going to end Johnny's turn. We'll mark him as previously activated. And I think next we're going to activate Nikki. She's more in the center of the board here. And we'll give her a roll for movement, and we'll let the movement roll dictate to us what she's going to do. Okay, here's her roll. She rolls a 6. So she's got plenty of movement available to her. And I think Nikki's going to head to the airplane hangar. That will allow her to utilize that exploration token that's there. And then, in a future turn, pickup item there is that signal flare, which is in the discard pile. So I think that makes sense. So we'll have her use that movement, those movement points to get to the airplane hangar. So we'll move her 1, 2, and 3. She goes into the hangar. We'll be able to use that exploration token. And that's a free search. So she's going to gain a hero card. And that card is Hopeful Discovery. That's a play immediately card. It says, look at the top 5 cards of the hero deck. Choose 1 to take, one to discard, and put the rest back on top of the deck in any order. That's what she's going to do. All right, and we revealed some good cards. There's a pump shotgun, stockpile first aid, recovery, a tire iron, and more dynamite. So I think what Nikki's going to do is she's going to take the pump shotgun. We'll give that to her. And I think she is going to discard the recovery card. It'll be discarded. And then we can put the other cards back in any order that we wish. And I think we'll start probably with the dynamite on top, the tire iron next, and then followed by the stockpile first aid. That was a great round for Nikki. All right, next up for Nikki is the ranged attack step. Now she has that pump shotgun that has a range of 2. So that's these zombies here are easily in range, 1 and 2. And that pump shotgun says you may fire at a space within range. Roll a d6 for each zombie in that space. Zombies are hit on a roll of 3+. Any hero in that space is unaffected. Each time the shotgun is fired, roll a d6. On a roll of 1 to 2, the shotgun is out of ammo. Discard. All right, before I forget, when Johnny threw that dynamite and killed the 3 zombies, he should have earned himself 3 XP, one for each of those zombies that he killed. So we're going to add those to his card. I just wanted to make sure I did not forget that. Now the pump shotgun attack from Nikki. She's targeting the 3 zombies over here, and it's a range of 2. She's going to kill them on any result of a 3 or greater, and then we're going to have to roll to see if the shotgun is out of ammo. Here's the roll. And she's got 3 successes, a 6, a 6, and a 5. So all 3 of those zombies are killed. That's going to move us up to 9 zombies killed, and that's going to give Nikki 3 more experience points, giving her a total of 4. And now we have to roll to see if the pump shotgun is out of ammo. On a 1 or 2, she's going to have to discard it. She rolls a 3, so she still maintains possession of that pump shotgun. That's great. And we're going to place these dead zombies into the pool. There's a total of 9 of them now. And that would complete Nikki's turn. There will be no fight zombies. She's not in a space with any zombies, but I think I might have her convert those experience tokens into an upgrade. So she's going to pay 3 XP, and that will allow her to draw a card from the Hero Upgrades decks. Now she can choose from ranged, melee, or special. I guess since she has that pump shotgun, we could draw from the ranged deck, but there's no guarantee that she's going to keep that. So I think to be on the safe side, I'm going to draw from the specials deck. And that card is revealed to be Awareness. Anytime you roll a 1 for move, you may draw a hero card. And that can be boosted to now on a move roll of 1 or 2. So that's pretty good. We'll add that card to Nikki, and that's going to complete her turn. And now that leaves us with Father Joseph left. He has 2 XP right now. He has a couple zombies in the church. We've already killed 9 of the 15 that we need to kill. So I think what we're going to do is we'll have Father Joseph roll for movement. And I'm going to try to get him into one of the buildings where he can draw an exploration token. All right, so Father Joe will roll for movement. And he ends up with a 2, so he's got 2 movement points he can use. And I think what he's going to do is he can't reach a location this turn with an exploration token. So I think I'm just going to give him some space and we'll move him maybe towards the diner where he could get in maybe next turn. So we're going to move him 1 and 2, give him a little space from these other zombies. And I believe that is going to end his turn. And I think what I'm going to do is I'm going to end the video here. What I'm going to do is I'm going to store these videos in a folder called Last Night on Earth campaign, and I'm going to put all of the files that come from this in that folder so that they could be watched all consecutively if someone chooses to. And I think what I'm going to do is, since this is an ongoing campaign, I will periodically play scenarios to move the campaign along, but this won't be the primary videos coming off the channel. I'll intersperse those with other videos from other games. I think that's probably the best way to handle this. All right, well, thanks for tuning in to the Solo Gamers Club, and I will hope to see you again soon, where we're going to continue the action of this first round of the campaign. Once that's completed, we'll probably move on to a different game. I did get a new title in the mail, which I'm kind of anxious to present to the channel. Thank you very much for watching, and have a good evening.